Hey guys, thanks for coming back to the Zen Garden Oasis channel. And today I'm talking about succulents. I've been growing succulents for well over a decade. I have a garden window in my house, and so they are in the perfect location. But what happens with a lot of succulents for a lot of people is they grow too slowly, or they feel like they're growing too slowly. I'm going to go over every possible step along that journey of growing succulents and how to speed up that growth so you can take a succulent of this size and get it to this size in the shortest amount of time possible. So guys, succulents are plants that grow in extremely arid and dry environments. And so overwatering is a very, very easy thing to do, and rotting out your succulents often happens for a lot of people. So I'm going to go step by step on what to do. And at the end, I'll talk about everything not to do. But what you want to do is you want to follow a very specific set of rules when growing these. And we're going to go step by step in the how-to of each point. And that way you can have the most healthiest succulents that will grow in the shortest amount of time to their maximum size. Now, some of these are dwarf size, but then some of them will get to a medium size. And some succulents you buy, you may have a problem keeping them inside because they can get really big. So obviously, since these grow in such a almost desert-like environment, some of them actually do grow in desert-like environments, you're going to want to invest in a light meter, whether it's one like this or a very, very high dollar light meter that can give you hour by hour readings, but they're going to need a lot of light. So that's one thing to remember, is a good meter will tell you how much light it's getting. You're going to need between 12 and 14 hours of really good light. So you might want to invest also in an LED grow light and make sure that's a really quality one, because that's critical on your succulent survival. So one of the things to consider if you're growing succulents indoors is to place them on a south facing window. If that's not possible, then a west-facing window to have the maximum amount of sunlight on them each day. Now, another thing that I rarely hear talked about is also rotating the succulent plants. If it's in a window, you may want to turn it around and have it facing the window in the opposite direction so it can get the maximum amount of light each day. So you want to monitor your succulents very careful. If it's getting too much sunlight, if you live in a more southern area and it's getting too much, there's a chance of sunburn or something like that, stretching or overgrowth. So you want to pay close attention to that. If it's not getting enough, that's when you want to consider that grow light. The next thing I want to talk about is temperature control. And this little meter right here will give me the temperature of the soil. And you also want a reading of the air around the succulent. And I've got this remote sensing that will send it to me wirelessly, and I can tell exactly what the temperature is around the succulent. So you want to protect it from extreme temperature fluctuations. The perfect and ideal temperature for your succulents is between 60 and 80 degrees. Now also, if you're keeping the succulents in an unheated basement or garage, you're definitely going to want to use a grow mat where you'll have that very, very gentle heat from underneath. But that's one of those things that you're absolutely going to need in an unheated garage or basement. But you're going to also need that light. So if you don't have the light and you don't have the heat, then you're going to have problems. Now, in the dead of summer, when the sun is at its most intense, you might want to consider moving them out of that window and under a grow light, because you can get, even though these are desert plants, even at that point, they can get too much sun. Now, if you can ventilate the area where they're at, that's even better, because you want to have some air moving in that area. I would recommend putting a very small fan on a timer so there's not just stagnant air around the succulents 24 hours a day. Just a couple of hours a day would really help if it has air movement, or if you can open a window near the succulents in the warmer months of the year. Now, another important thing to remember is you want to monitor your soil nutrient level by using a meter that will give you an exact reading of the nutrition level in the soil. A good balanced fertilizer like Osmocote is a great one to use. It's really a slow-release fertilizer that I use completely on my bonsai. I occasionally give them a water soluble, but this one is the workhorse. Now, if you're using a liquid based fertilizer, I would recommend diluting it to 50% of the recommended dosage for succulents. I would also recommend fertilizing your succulents in the summer during the growing season every 4 to 6 weeks, late spring, summer, and early fall, every 4 to 6 weeks. Another thing to do right before you fertilize is make sure that you water each succulent as well, because you want to prevent burn from those nutrients, that sudden blast if you are using a liquid-based fertilizer. So make sure you water everything first so you can kind of prevent that from happening. You also want to avoid fertilization during the winter months and the dormant months, when it's not a good idea to do that. So always avoid that in the winter months, unless you're in a tropical or very, very, very warm environment. Now, even if you're doing all the things in this guide, there is different types of succulents that are going to grow faster than others. So I recommend that you research like sedum. It will grow much faster than other succulents. So that's one thing that's important is research and find out which one is going to give you the fastest growth. If that's what you're wanting, the largest succulent possible in the shortest amount of time. Now, if you're growing outside, you're going to want to research the succulents that are going to most thrive in your environment. A zone 4 or 5 is going to be completely different than a zone 7, 8, or 9. So that's one thing to consider is doing a little bit of research and find out which succulents are being most often grown in your climate. Going to a local nursery and asking an expert is always a great thing to do, which ones they're selling the most of. Now, one of my favorite things to see is a large pot with many, many succulents inside of it. And that can look great, but it can be a stress on each individual succulent plant because what it's doing is competing for moisture, is competing for nutrition. So I would say you want to do, if your goal is the fastest possible growth for each type, give it its own pot, and it needs to be at least 2 to 3 inches larger minimum than its root ball. You don't want to go massive on a tiny succulent like this, but you just want to give the roots plenty of room to grow. Now, typically about once every 2 to 3 years, you're going to want to repot your succulents and make sure, take a look and see if the root ball is getting too big for the pot. It may be longer than 3 years, but that's just a good common practice every 2 to 3 years. Now you want to make sure that the pot you use has adequate drainage holes, because if it just has one tiny hole in there, that can totally destroy the pot, the plant, and cause a lot of root rot. So make sure that whatever you're using, whatever pot, it has very good size, large drainage holes. If I do have that in there and I'm worried about soil washout, I'll put a paper towel at the bottom of the pot and that will allow moisture to pass through, retain all of the soil. Now these pots already have this built in. If you notice, there's a small feet around all four. These are used mainly for bonsai training pots and they're made out of plastic. But if you have a pot that's sitting flat on your concrete or porch or wherever you have it, you want to put feet under it so it'll be lifted off the ground just a little bit, which will improve drainage and also allow better airflow. Now I picked up some of these just yesterday and there were some dead limbs and leaves on them. And so that's another thing to remember. Remove those dead leaves and limbs as quickly as you can so that energy will be directed back to the plant and its overall growth, and that will speed it up. Now, another thing to remember as you're doing that little tiny surgery you're doing on your succulents on dead limbs or branches or leaves, if you decide to use a very good pair of pruning devices like these, this is a very good set of cutters that I like because I can reach in there and get in between very tiny spaces, unlike my general garden pruners. Always remember, the point I'm getting to is always remember to sterilize it. I always sterilize with just the common generic brand of Listerine. I spray it on there and then wipe it off and it works great. It's a really good way to prevent anything from happening. Also, when you are changing out pots and putting them in new pots, make sure you do the same thing in the pot. Spray the pot with the rubbing alcohol and wipe it down and give it a light rinse. And that way you're not introducing a disease to your succulent. Now, soil is just as important as light or water for succulents as it is for most plants. But what I'm doing is I'm taking a potting mix specifically made for succulents, but I'm adding two things to it. I'm adding this product right here, and I think they sell it on Amazon. I purchased it before in smaller quantities, a small bag. But this is Turfus. It's used in baseball fields to allow drainage out on the field when there's a rain. It gets the water out of the field very quickly. And so that's a really important thing to use, is something like this that allows for very quick draining from the water from the soil so you don't have that chance of rot. The other product I use is just general coarse sand. I like to add these two, about one part succulent or cactus potting mix and one part of the Turfus and one part sand. That is a really fast draining soil, and it's exactly what succulents and cacti need. Now, despite coming from an arid and desert environment, they do like a little bit of misting from time to time. So if you can purchase a good mister, I know the hand pumps are great, but I really love this one because I can charge it up, mist, and it'll stay charged for a pretty long time. So that's another thing, is you want to mist about once every other day to make sure your succulents have a lot of moisture on the surface and not down below, but they're getting that daily moisture that they would receive out in their natural environment that sometimes happens early in the morning in those arid environments. Now, speaking of watering, you want your succulents to be dry for the first 1 to 2 inches before you water to allow them to experience that little bit of drought-like sensation, because if you have too much water all the way to the surface every day, you're almost certainly going to have root rot. So remember, allow that first 1 to 2 inches to become dry. And if you're not sure, You can put your finger in there. If you're afraid you're going to damage the root system, use a probe like this that will give you an exact reading, and you can easily see where you would do 1, 2, whatever size depth, whatever depth you want to go to. So use a soil meter like this. I'll put the description to all these products I'm talking about in the links, but a soil meter is invaluable for almost every part of your garden. Now in this video tutorial, I'm not going to go deep into watering as I'm making another completely separate video for very detailed watering instructions on succulents and cacti, but you want to water infrequently. Don't water every day. Now, succulents need much less water in winter. So if you're keeping them in a garden window, in an unheated basement or garage, just remember you're going to cut way back on your watering schedule in the winter, maybe only once a month or once every other month, because they're going to really slow down on the growth. But remember, use the meter and you'll know when the soil is really too dry and it needs to be watered. Another note about watering, it's better to water early in the day and allow the soil to dry throughout the day, so overnight you don't chance any fungal issues. When you are watering, try to water, and this little device is great. I just picked this up a couple weeks ago, and the first one I had disappeared somewhere, so I don't know where it's at. But this is a great device where you can go in and you can water directly at the base. You don't want to water up top unless you're trying to clean off leaves or something like that, but just when you're doing your normal watering schedule, take one of these and water at the base of the roots, can I say that? And then that way you're getting the water right where it needs rather than chancing more fungal issues on the top of the plant. So just remember, water at the base. So if you don't have enough time during your schedule to do normal watering, a tray below the pot would be great, especially if it's made out of terracotta, because that can absorb in the excess moisture and help with evaporation a little. So a plastic tray probably wouldn't be as good. So this is a little bit better, even though I'm not a big fan of terracotta because it's so easily broken. I would use that to put your succulents in and then carefully water just a little bit. You don't want to fill the tray up all the way up to the edges. You just want to give it just enough water so it can pull the water up through its watering hole, and that will help water from beneath directly to the roots. Now consider adding a layer of horticultural charcoal to the bottom of your pot. That will help absorb excess moisture and also help with some odors and possibly some other disease issues as well. Charcoal is a great thing, horticultural charcoal. I'll link some of that as well. Now, pH is something a lot of people don't talk about with succulents, but it is important to have your pH just a little bit on the acidic side. So one of these meters will help you quite a bit. The ideal, generally speaking, the ideal level for pH on succulents is between 6 and 7. Not neutral, but slightly more acidic. So if you find that your pH meter is telling you you're too alkaline, just do some soil amendments and that can bring it down a little bit by using something like peat moss. Just add a little bit of that to the top and that will bring down your pH to a more acidic level, but not too much. Now you want to remember, when you are potting for the first time or you're repotting, you don't want to use general garden soil or a general potting soil. It's got too much organic matter in it. And so you want to go with a specific soil that's made just for succulents and cacti. And you can add those amendments also, the ones I mentioned earlier, to help with drainage. So that's one of the things that's important. Don't use potting soil. Now you're going to want to occasionally do an inspection. If your plants are going indoors and outdoors from the winter to summer and then back inside, you want to make sure carefully inspect your plants for any aphids, mealybugs, or scale insects. And I always recommend neem oil because it's 100% natural. It's made from the seed of the neem tree. And I put it in my spray bottle, just dilute it. You don't want it too strong, but this is one of the most natural things you can use for those insects. Also, if you have other insects, you might try diatomaceous earth right on top of the soil. Both of these are perfectly safe and they should not harm 99.99% of any succulents. Monitor your succulents carefully for the two common diseases, which is root rot and powdery mildew. And you can use a special fungicide that's made specifically for succulents, and that will help you with those two issues. If you see that happening, I'll put a link to that as well. But that's one thing to remember, is you want to keep a very close watch on that. Now, if you do find that on any of your succulents, you want to pull back on your watering schedule and just keep a close eye on it. So you just need to learn to identify when there's a stress issue in your plants. If you see yellowing, wilting, some shriveling of the leaves, it could be too much water, insect infestation, or a fungal issue. So the most common thing probably is overwatering, because we tend to think they need more water than they actually do. But succulents can go quite a long time without water. Sometimes in the big box stores, you'll see these sitting on a shelf, And it could be months and months in the summertime in between watering. So that's one thing to remember, is you just want to look for those yellow leaves and other issues, wilting, browning, things like that. So guys, that is the way to speed up the growth of your succulents by following all of those tips and tricks. You just want to make sure that your succulent has the ideal conditions to grow in and that doesn't have anything hindering it. So anyways, I want to say thanks so much for watching. Have a great day, and I hope you like and subscribe if you found something useful.